Greetings, fellow gamers, and welcome to my channel. Today I'm gonna start a new Let's Discover series for the Lord of the Rings Online. It's a game that I had been playing for around 10 years, from the Siege of Mirkwood up to the epic story conclusion with the destruction of the ring. In this series I'm gonna start I will have a new start, the new race that I haven't tried before. This is the Stout-axe Dwarf and the Burglar, also a class I haven't tested or tried before. So we're going to focus on exploring and rediscovering the content of the Lord of the Rings and see what we can find that we haven't discovered yet. So let's begin. It appears we are in a dungeon. We are apparently in Barad-Dur, third age 3017th. So there are some doors here. It's apparently a prison cell. Lots of bones. It is intimidating. Let's see.
Even for him.
Okay, let's finish our rations. Or whatever that is. Okay. As good prisoners, we ate our food and now must dispose of the plate. Yes.
I don't know how you can eat that. Even the rats taste better.
I see. Okay, apparently there are some rumors about the ramblings. And we know nothing of it. Let's see what we find out. So they're planning a way out to escape. Tasha's folk is referred to the Stout Axes. Have lost their identity. Okay, there's disagreement apparently. Some want to break free, and some are afraid, I believe.
Nothing else for the order to hear.
So it's time to rest. Okay, I guess they're resting there. Let's sleep here. Regain our strength. Okay. Okay, so we're released from the cage. Who is that man? Dulu Zagar. Okay, let's see. Okay, apparently this is our prison. It's intimidating. We are, I guess, below Barad-Dur, some cave. Who knows? Okay, there's some mobs here. Lots of bones. Okay, let's see. Let's talk to him again. Okay, so must labor in the dungeons of Barad-Dur. Let's see. Our labors consist of collecting crude iron bars at Angnul, the Forge of Torment, collecting solid plates in the dungeons of Barad-Dur, defeating rats and maggots, break fallen rubble, and collect a bucket for the foul larder. Okay. Let's see. I see some rubble, plates, and apparently rats here. So we must clean this place up, sort of. We are slaves, so we don't have much of a choice. Either we do our job, our labors, or we will end up as the skeletons here. Some unlucky dwarf, apparently. It is really intimidating. It's very dark here, and you feel like depressed, like those dwarves. Let's try and stealth for this button with this maggot. It's like a warp. Okay, we defeated it. Lots of torture machines over here. Oh crap. Certainly the dwarves do not deserve that. Of course they are greedy, all of the dwarves, but that's a terrible fate. As a burglar, we need to attack from stealth or behind the target, the positional damage, in order to inflict maximum damage. Okay, here is Zoreth, some other man of Mordor. I don't know if they're Black Numenoreans or simply Easterlings. Both of those clans and factions of humans serve Sauron as well, especially the Easterlings. They pay tribute to Sauron either by supplies, by warriors, dwarf follow him to his wars. As far as the Numenoreans, there were some that resisted and were against him, as seen in the humans that founded Arnor and Gondor, the descendants of Elendil, Isildur and Anarion. And of course there are some that followed Sauron, corrupted even from Numenor. As so are the consorts of Umbar and lots of other people of Numenorean descent in the northern kingdoms, like Rudar, one of the three kingdoms of Arnor when they were split up. There are several other dwarves here, exhausted from laboring in the dungeons, apparently. Okay. Okay, so we found a stair, more torture machines. It's certainly intimidating to have all these creatures around you, rats, and worst of all, the servants of the Dark Lord. Okay, so we must... which quest is that? Let's see. Okay, so we must deliver a barrel of armor to the Uruk garrison captain, a barrel of spears, and a barrel of swords. This is barrel of armor. Apparently it's heavy, so we're moving slowly. Let's find him. Here's the other barrel. Okay. Some orcs over there. As far as the lore behind the Stout-axe goes, from the game's perspective, it's a clan of dwarves, one of the houses of dwarves, the seven houses, that while got a ring, one of the dwarven rings of power, in order to to rule that house and rise to power. They were really greedy, and when the Dark Lord demanded his ring back, they refused, and so they were attacked, besieged, and enslaved. And so they ended up from a proud house of dwarven descent into a faction that is enslaved to the Dark Lord, as many others. Of course, that is not specifically mentioned in any of the books, but there are references of dwarven clans and general dwarves fighting or working or allying with the Dark Lord, or even goblins, in order to gain riches, in order to gain power. So it's not unheard of dwarves either helping or serving or being enslaved to the Dark Lord or even goblins. Okay, we apparently cleared and cleaned the plates, but I believe that's something not to be taken very seriously, apparently. Okay, now let's fill the bucket with water. The dwarves are hardy folk. In general, they are resistant to shadow. They're resistant to corruption. Although they were given a ring of power, their lords were given rings of power. Although they were very greedy and used those rings to achieve many, to get power, to get riches, and so on, they were never in a point, they never reached the point that the humans, the race of man, reached, as with the ring wraiths. So they never became enslaved to the rings. The result, although was the same, they ended up losing everything due to their greed, and so they became enslaved or were killed and lost all their riches, their holds, their strongholds. And as it appears in this case of Stout-axes in the game, even their names or history, their legacy. Let's see. Let's take the barrel of swords and carry it upstairs. I remember that there's a similar quest, series of quests in Isengard. Spoiler alert, of course, later on the game, where we're imprisoned again, this time in Isengard, and we have to work similarly and labor in the dungeons of Isengard when we finally escape. Okay, so here is the Forge of Torment. Okay, lots of weapons here. I believe that Sauron enslaved the dwarves in order to have more slaves, and apparently he uses their skills, their crafting skills, to forge weapons. Dwarves are master crafters, especially what concerns weapons and armor, also jewels. The only other race that compares to them, and mostly in the past, were the Noldor, who were also master crafters of beautiful gems, armor, weapons, holds. Of course, there were many times that both these peoples and these races fought each other, and those grievances follow them to the Third Age. Of course, there are very few Noldor that remain in the Third Age in Middle-earth. So there are more generally grievances between dwarves and elves, and specifically the Noldor. The Noldor are a sub-faction of the elves, of the high elves specifically. It's a faction that it's Valinor, the land of the gods, and saw the light of the two trees. Those trees were Lorelin and Telperion. Lorelin is the name of the server I'm playing on, and those trees were destroyed by Morgoth, the first Dark Lord. So Noldor were a race of elves that learned from the gods, lived beside the gods, and for that they grew in power and skill, and of course arrogance. So now we must present to Zoreth in order to receive further instructions. Zoreth is down below here in the dungeons. Lots of stories starting in the first age, either with elves or dwarves, follow characters and races up to the third age, when we are actually fighting and living in the game, when the events of the War of the Ring and the Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings take place. Let's see what he wants. Okay, it seems we will make acquaintance of Mouth of Sauron and the Witch King, and we are about to be sent to Minas Morgul, apparently, to labor there. Minas Morgul is the city of Isildur. It's the sister city of Minas Tirith. It's located on the eastern side of Anduin, the great river. And it has fallen to the Nazgul. It's now the lair of Witch King of Angmar, the Lord of the Nazgul. Of course, its name was Minas Ithil when it was built. It's the Tower of the Moon. As well as Minas Tirith was originally Minas Anor, which means the Tower of the Sun. Something's going on here. Lots of bodies. Holy crap. Orcs, man, men, and dwarves. Let's see. Apparently the revolution has begun and some Stout-axes try to escape, wreaking havoc in the way. So apparently we must go to the gates of Barad-Dur, or try to go there and escape. Okay, so we are inside Barad-Dur. It's certainly has a nice feel. The atmosphere is dark. There are orcs fighting orcs, orcs fighting dwarves. It's not uncommon for orcs to fight between them, several different factions of orcs, as it can be seen in the Lord of the Rings books, where in Cirith Ungol, the tower that guards the entrance to Mordor, one of the entrances, and we see that the orcs for Mordor and the Morgul orcs fight between them.
All of this can't be us, can it?
Yeah, as it says, orcs fight amongst themselves. Let's see where that will go. It's really a massacre. Lots of brave dwarves
perished. I can still move my arm. Slice a throat.
I see. Okay, let's get a dagger, as we are burglars. I believe that's more suitable for us. Okay. We're to fighting. Okay. We are very weak, but this orcs are battle weary. But we can take them. That's golden. Oh crap! So that's interesting. Our revolt and the prisoner that the other dwarf—I don't remember his name—said in the beginning was actually Gollum, which was released, quote unquote, from the dungeons of Barad-Dur just before the events of the Lord of the Rings, when he was tortured and gave away the location of the last location of the ring known to him, that is the Shire and Baggins, meaning Bilbo Baggins. So then he was released from the dungeons of Barad-Dur in order to try and find the ring, or lead perhaps the Nazgul to the ring. That's very interesting way to connect those two stories. No wonder he wanted to be rid of me. I see.
Far now, but I fear the worst is still ahead of us.
It seems quiet. Yeah, and lots of dead around here. Orcs, dwarves. Okay, so I am to disguise myself as an orc captain. That's hilarious. It's like a little Viking.
I think that might just fool them.
Okay, so we need to scout ahead the doors. Okay. There's an orc here. So let's scout.
What did you see? Is the way clear?
Lots of brave dwarves are dead here. Let's see what he will do. So he reached the Blue Mountains. And we are at Ered Luin now. After a long journey, I'm sure. So. Okay, so we are at the doorsteps of Noglund. At the Vale of Thrain. There are some Darhans here. Okay, let's see.
That was quite the story.
So the Darhans are descendants from one of the two Dwarven clans that dwelled in Ered Luin during the First Age. There were two great cities there, Nogrod and Belegost, if I remember correctly. Those two cities were destroyed during the War of Wrath. At the end of the First Age of Middle-earth, and the surviving dwarves fled to Moria, the kingdom of Khazad-dûm, to join the Longbeards. Of course, some descendants of those clans are Darhans and are not in very good terms with Longbeards, apparently. I see. Let's see if we can make a new home here.
Yes.
Those are familiar figures. Skorgrim Darhand and Ivar the Bloodhand. For those of you that haven't played the Dwarven or Elven introduction, Ivar the Bloodhand awakens Skorgrim, but of course uses vile sorcery, and it's not the Dwarven King himself, but a puppet. So actually Ivar controls Skorgrim in order to rally the Darhands to his cause and cause trouble to the free peoples, especially the Longbirds. Even his eyes seem weird. So they want to ally with Angmar and use Darhand power to join them and avenge the free peoples. That's all Ivar the Bloodhand is doing. So we must try and persuade some of them. Of course, dwarves are very loyal to their lord and their king, and they are stubborn beyond belief. But besides that, they're also arrogant and greedy. As it said here, the steward, Gomer Darhand, was appointed by Thorin Oakenshield before leaving for the adventure and the events of the Hobbit to reclaim Erebor, the Lonely Mountain. So the Darhands were in control of Thorin's Hall and have left, have not done everything in their power to restore and make it flourish, but instead seek to revive their king of old and bring power to their cause and their faction.
Something troubles me about Skorgrim's words.
Let's see. So we're going to Thorin's Hall to find out what happened. Okay, so this is our hall, Thorin's Halls. Quite different from the later version.
I suppose this is as far as I'm to go.
Okay, let's talk to Dwalik then. I guess he's up there on the throne. Dwalin is a non-Dwalin, brother of Balin, that joined Thorin on his expedition to the Lonely Mountain. Apparently, I've given refuge here, and now the introduction is completed, and we're Thorin's Hall the year, the following year, years, it's not specified.
It is time, I think, for you to venture back into the world.
So it's several months past the events of the introduction. And have labored to restore the halls of Thorin. Okay. So, introduction is finished.
I almost forgot. Your Dourhand companion Nagli is planning to depart on a journey of his own.
So Nagli's planning to depart, and we must go talk to him. So, this is our first episode. We started an adventure to rediscover the Lord of the Rings. Discover its content, its peoples, and find out what it, how it has changed the past years, and see what else we can find. So, if you like the video, like, comment, and subscribe to follow, and join me on this adventure. Bye, everyone.